There he is. Come on, eat it. There you go. Nice job, buddy.
And there's a lot of different kinds of tarpon fishing. There's a lot of different kinds of tackle that you can use, but fly fishing for tarpon is, it's the most exciting fishing that I know.
Tons more fish coming from the right, like lots more.
And right where we are is one of the best places in the world to be sitting out on the ocean and getting shots at tarpon with a fly rod.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Yes, sir. Oh.
Oh, yeah. Come on, come on. Oh, he ate it. He ate it. He ate it.
Nice, baby. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
I thought you said you
had to. Look at him, relax.
Oh, dude, relax. He just ripped my boat off. Oh. Awesome. Look at that big boy. Woo.
K Saltwater Experience, presented by Yellowfin, with Captain Tom Rowland and Captain Rich Tudor.
So we had the perfect morning to go fly fishing for tarpon.
Yeah, well, anytime there's tarpon around, it's nice and calm and we can get up real early, that's probably the perfect morning. That's one of my favorite things to do. And this was just textbook, man. Leave the dock in the dark, run across the bay in the dark, go back into the Everglades. The Everglades is a place where pretty good chance you're gonna get some bites.
Nothing better than running back into the bay in the mornings there, and you know, with high anticipation, because a morning like that, you know, you're gonna be able to see them roll. And although there's not as many fish back there usually, as far as, you know, once we get shots right here, I know that if we get shots of those fish are eating, especially that first half hour of the day, and you know, we get back there and start looking around with the binoculars, see a couple here, a couple there, you see one roll, one bust. I mean, so we knew we were in the zone.
Well, what a sunrise. It's always so pretty up here in the morning, quiet. Let's hope we can get one of these tarpon to make some noise.
Yeah. You know, it wasn't one of these scenarios where we could see the bodies in the water. We just had to see a little roll, or, you know, almost get lucky that they roll in range.
Right there, turn me. Or you don't have to turn me, just stay right here. Come on. There are multiple fish there.
Yeah, I'd go again. No, they weren't moving fast either.
There he is. Come on, eat it. There you go. Nice job, buddy. Come on.
Oh, he had him, bud. That was cool.
I got him.
That was cool. He liked that black little worm. And sure enough, man, one rolled in range, and I think you made a little back cast right over there and immediately came tight on him.
Yeah, and boy, talk about expectation. I mean, when you go out there and the fish are where you think they are, they're doing what you think they should be doing, you make one cast and hook a fish, you're thinking, man, this is gonna be the best day of tarpon fishing ever. But a lot of times, for whatever reason, that does happen. Like, you get there, first cast, boom, you hook something, and then, boy, does it get harder sometimes.
Sweet. There's more in there. Sweet.
Got the bite.
They act getting little, up in the morning for, huh?
They act a little different in the morning.
That'll make you wake up at 4 a.m.
And it did get harder on this situation because, you know, one of the reasons why it's going to get more difficult there is because the tarpon is a nocturnal fish. They're out there, a lot of what they're eating are nocturnal things. The shrimp are more active, the crabs are more active, maybe even the little fish are more active, but whatever is going on there, everything is happening until a certain part of the day where the sun gets up to a little bit higher, and all of a sudden you've been seeing rolls, busts, eats, shrimp hopping out of the water, and then it just goes real quiet.
Game over.
And you'll see maybe one more roll. Come on, boys, give us a little sign. That sun gets up too much higher, it's just going to be over. And it is an angle of the sun kind of thing, because when you have a day where it's very, very cloudy, you could see this activity lasting not until 8 o'clock and stopping, but until 11 o'clock. You could be out there and they're rolling around because the light level is consistent to what they like until 11 or even noon some days, and they continue to do their thing, and those are awesome days. This one, we saw this beautiful, incredible sunset, but it was kind of like what we're looking at right here. Like, there's clouds kind of on the horizon, the middle of the sky is totally clear, so the sun gets up, those fish stop rolling, and we've got to start looking for them in different types of areas.
I think it's drying up, man.
Once that sun got up just high enough, they kind of stopped rolling, or we pulled out of them or something, but.
Well, I think those fish on the ocean might be good this afternoon. We got a great tide for it right out in front of Hawks Cay.
And we got good sun, got great sun. So let's try that.
Sounds good. That was a fun morning though.
Yeah, got a couple to bite. It's a tricky situation in there. And you can't really see them very good, but I promise you we'll see them better where we're going. They may not bite better, but we'll see them better there.
The Hawks Cay Saltwater Experience, presented by Yellowfin, is brought to you by Hawks Cay. Find what lures you. Lowrance, America's number one fish finder. Waypoint, the destination for outdoor entertainment. Mercury Marine, go boldly. St. Croix Rods, the best rods on earth. Marathon, in the Florida Keys. And by Ameritrail Trailers, Daiwa. Black Rifle Coffee Company, Power Pole, and Reflex Boat Decking.
We had that great flurry there for a little while in the morning, and besides the sun getting up too high, it was also the tide really wasn't just right for us. We didn't have that good outgoing tide early in the morning, and so you know, the fish weren't that active, and it really seemed like, you know, where we knew we were gonna have some good action was right back here, right in front of Duck Key. I mean, fishing right in front of Hawks Cay is, you know, probably the best during the middle of the day. We've got the high sun, we can see them moving, so I was excited to get out there.
And that's interesting too, because we're talking about how the tarpon's nocturnal and they're feeding the most at night, but then we're gonna move to a different area where we're gonna look for the highest sun possible, the brightest area possible, no clouds, but we want those conditions because we wanna see them from the furthest distance away so that we can set the boat up so that we can get this shot. And the shot that we're looking for is like 180 degrees going away from the fish. So we can put the fly in there, and if that fly is crossing the fish, you got some sort of a good opportunity. But if you can lay it out there to where the fish kind of swims up to it and you keep it right in the fish's face for a long time and it's going directly away from it, boy, that is a much higher percentage shot. That is where the teamwork comes in between the fly angler and the guide, or the person poling and the person casting. But the thing is that there's so many fish coming down that it's a high opportunity kind of thing, low percentage.
Okay, you're almost in range. I can see the bodies. Go ahead. Hair to the right, you're good. Right in there anywhere. You're just 5 feet past them. They're turning towards us head on right now. Should be coming through some of them. Come on. Tons more fish coming from the right. Like, lots more. As far as you can see. I mean, you can cast it as far as you want. There's tons of fish. You're perfectly in line. I think that's the end of them now.
That's a good shot. That was a really good shot.
Yeah.
I didn't see anybody show any interest whatsoever.
I couldn't tell.
I don't know what I could have done better. Maybe a little... had a fly that was a little deeper, but it was right in there.
But one thing about the ocean fishing, and especially fly fishing for them, is that you can get that right shot over and over, and you're doing everything exactly right, but you're not getting the bite. And a lot of people can get very frustrated with this, including the guide. Like, maybe the guide more than anybody. Like, it's like, no, you gotta do it just a little bit different, a little bit different. And then it's easy to say, well, this is what needs to happen, but then the wind's blowing, the current's moving, the boat's moving. This is a hard sport.
It is.
It really is.
Hard.
And you're not always successful.
Solid fish.
You're in him good.
Coming. It's coming. It's coming. It's coming. This is the shot right here.
Solid fish to the right, too. Coming straight at us.
It's a high number of opportunities with a low success rate. But it's just so beautiful that that's what just gets people's passion going for these fish, is that you see these groups of 5, 10, 50, 150 tarpon coming at you, either in a big clump or a long string or any sort of combination of those things. And right where we are is one of the best places in the world to be sitting out on the ocean and getting shots at tarpon with a fly rod.
That was a hell of a school of fish. There they are, 12, happy still, finning up.
Fly looks good. I don't know what I could do different, man.
Just keep doing it. Okay, you're in. Go a little further. Come head on right now. Still got plenty coming. Still plenty coming. There's tons of them to the right too. You're really good right now. You let a new batch come to you. Nope, there. Right in the meat. Come on.
Come on. That was as good as it gets right there, man. That was as good as it gets.
Yep. Everything but a bite.
You know, this time of the year, it would be outside of the norm to not see much out there. But there are days where that doesn't happen. They're just not flowing on the ocean like they should. But in this situation, they definitely were. There was no shortage of opportunities. And the more I learn about tarpon, the more I think we all need to learn more about tarpon. I just think that they're just a mysterious fish. But one of the things that we could learn a lot more about as far as the tarpon goes is how to catch them on fly on the ocean. Because even the best of the best, even the guys that are doing this and specializing in how do we do this better, and that's going to be longer leaders, it's going to be smaller flies, it's going to be slightly different retrievals, it's going to be just the tiniest little nuances can make the biggest differences.
Wait. Bump it, he's after you, he's after you. He followed it, that one wanted it. That's the best we've seen yet.
A little smaller one, but he definitely...
A little time to let it sink too. And one kind of smooth.
That was a totally different deal, man. Yeah. That fish,
he wanted
looked
it.
At it, he saw it, he wanted to eat it.
He wanted it.
That is way better than anything we've seen here. They're coming right here, stop.
Yeah. I like that we have many different types of opportunities there. We had single fish that are coming down, and we see this single fish coming, adjust the boat, move it over a little bit, make the cast. Maybe we get a lean or a look, maybe we don't. Then we had strings of fish, one after another in a straight line,
kind
of head to tail coming at you. Then we had like a meatball of fish where you see like a dark mass moving at you. And as they get closer and closer, you're like, okay, they're actually moving in daisy chains. We saw just about every type of formation that the tarpon is going to take out here on the ocean. We made so many different casts and adjustments, longer leaders, lighter leaders, smaller flies, bigger flies. It all boils down to, it is a very difficult thing to do. Tarpon fishing on the ocean, on fly, that is a hard thing to do. But we're not actually out there to just catch a tarpon. We're out there to experience this incredible opportunity that we really only have in the Florida Keys.
That was really good.
Yeah.
Fly looks good, man. Wasn't that?
I'm just gonna see if these guys will settle down again.
Yeah. That we had one in there that wanted to play ball.
Yeah.
One of the most common questions we're asked is, what's the secret to catching more and bigger fish? And while there's not a single secret, there are a couple of things that I've learned over the course of all these years that I'd be happy to share with you. And they are, I mean, they're all kind of like a secret because not everybody does it. And that is using good quality binoculars, whether you're offshore or inshore, to help with your fishing. The way that I use these is obviously to look out offshore for birds and bird activity. Further you can see out there, maybe you'll be the first boat on it. That's a given. But on the inshore side, we're using these binoculars, especially on calm days, for the fish that are going to show us anything. Permit will tail, bonefish will tail, redfish will tail, tarpon will roll. Those are primarily the fish that I'm looking for. And while I'm looking for those fish and I can clearly see them tailing from a further distance away than I would be able to see just with my naked eye, I might be able to look with the binoculars and see, oh, that's a small shark instead of that's a bonefish, meaning I don't want to go over there. We're going to look somewhere else and we're going to save a tremendous amount of time. So while we're looking for things on the surface, it really, really helps to be able to see further than with your naked eye. The other day we were looking for permit and there were some cormorants up in the slick water and they were pushing. It looked very, very similar to the permit. We're looking, oh, that's a cormorant. And boom, there are permit over here. They're just sticking their fins up maybe a quarter of an inch, and from a long, long way away with a good pair of binoculars, you're able to see that. We can engage and go and start to catch those fish. With the Nikons here, I found that the 42 binoculars are my favorite for both inshore, offshore, and hunting. It gives me a big picture and allows me to gather a lot of light. The choices from that would be whether I want an 8-power or a 10-power. I have 8 powers here and 10 powers here in the Nikon line. The difference between an 8-power and a 10-power as far as fishing goes is that the higher power is going to take every little shake of the boat or your hand and magnify it. So I'm going to be able to hold a picture and see better offshore with the 8-power rather than the 10-power. So once you decide on the power, then you can decide on the price point and what you want to spend on a pair of binoculars. In the Nikon line of binoculars, they make them very affordable and very high quality. And we have the Pro Staff model and the Monarch. The big difference here is that the P3, they're very good. The P7, a little bit better, and the Monarch, they're the best. The primary difference between these are weight and also a coating that makes it easier to clean off the salt water and everything else that gets on them. All of these are waterproof and fogproof and dropproof, which is incredibly important to me, whether I'm hunting or fishing. So if you're looking for the secret to catch more bigger fish, whether that's inshore or offshore, getting a good pair of quality binoculars is a great start. Nikon has a great line with a lot of variety and a lot of price points, so you can get exactly what you're looking for at exactly what you want to spend.
The Hawks K Saltwater Experience, presented by Yellowfin, is brought to you by Yellowfin. Live deeper. Hook. Tackle Direct, the world's premier fishing outfitter. Yeti, built for the wild. Key Largo, in the Florida Keys. And by Golden Boat Lifts. Power Pole Move. Nikon. And Lithium Pros.
Did you know you can get every episode of Saltwater Experience completely free on Waypoint TV? Go to waypointtv.com and find out how you can download the app or find it on any smart TV. And if that's not enough, you can find the Tom Rowland Podcast on Apple, Spotify, or anywhere you find podcasts. And we'd love to have you as a follower on Instagram, Facebook, and YouTube.
Catch one here. I like the current flow. It's hard, yeah. hard to pull in.
You can hold here. We're good.
You got some back here if you want to try.
We're getting much better shots here.
He ate it. Yes, oh. Sir. Oh, he ate the crap out of that.
He did. I like this so much better than where we were before because there's current. There's so much more current. But he just slipped right out of there and
he ate the took a bite out of that.
I hope I didn't break the hook. See what happened.
Oh, he ate the crap.
I thought I had a pretty good hook set on him, but.
That was okay. Cool.
Got bit. Got bit.
This is not a type of fishing where you catch a lot of tarpon doing what we're doing on the ocean. You got to go into it knowing that. Like this is, you're going to get a lot of shots. You might catch one. And if you do it exactly right, over and over and over again, you'll get a bite. Any one of these casts could be the bite, and it could be the only bite of the day. So you have to be able to keep your head, keep cool, and do everything exactly right. And that is a really, really, really hard thing to do. Sooner or later, one's probably gonna bite it, but man, it's the most exciting fishing that I know is fly fishing for tarpon. And we're just so fortunate that we have it right here. Right here at Hawks Cay is one of the best places in the Florida Keys, and in that case, in the world.
Rich, I think our time is, we've run out.
Yeah, it's been fun.
It has been, man. Thanks for polling so much. I feel like I kind of let you down a little.
Fun to watch, you got a couple bites.
Yeah, they can be tough, man. They can be tough, but you know, when you get a bite, be thankful.
Not many things cooler than seeing giant tarpon flooding by you by the thousands.